I'm just so excited to introduce this person because this is really a personal hero, a heroine for me. In 2005, she broke the world record as the fastest person ever to circumnavigate the globe. The achievement is massive, but this is by a woman. She even has an asteroid named after her. She's the founder of the Ellen MacArthur Cancer Trust and the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. And she's here today to talk to you about her new passion, which is the circular economy and how we, all of us, make the world more sustainable. Please give a huge One Young World welcome to the one and only Dame Ellen MacArthur.
Welcome. No, I'll go disturb your mic.
Go, girl.
When you're a child, anything and everything seems possible. And the challenge so often in life is hanging on to that as we grow up. And for me, as a child aged just 4 years, I had the opportunity to sail for the first time. I will never, ever forget the feeling that I felt. As we hoisted those sails, I felt the greatest sense of freedom that I could ever imagine. And there and then, I decided that one day, somehow, I would sail solo around the world. I had absolutely no idea how to make that happen, but I knew exactly where I was headed. So I tried in my life to make the steps that I could to get me close to that goal. As an 8-year-old child, that was saving birthday and Christmas money. When I got to secondary school, aged 11, I got control of my school dinner money, and every day I had mashed potato and beans, saving all the change. And when that little pile of change reached a pound, I would drop it into my money box. And eventually, when I got to 100, which was very rarely, I would go along to the bank and I would put that money in. And so when I finally bought the little dinghy that sat in the garden at home in Derbyshire in the UK, which is about as far away from the sea as you can possibly get, I dreamt of sailing. I dreamt and I dreamt and I read every single book that I could possibly read because I wanted to get close to that sport that in the countryside was quite literally miles and miles away. So imagine how it felt just 4 years after leaving secondary school to be sitting in a boardroom, having sent over 2,000 letters in front of a CEO, the head of a company who I knew could say yes or no to that dream coming true. I was so nervous, my knees were knocking beneath the table because I knew that was the deciding moment. That doesn't happen every day in our lives. And when he said yes, and we began the process to design a boat on which I would sail around the world, I could not believe that I was living my life. When I sat in the design studio with the designers and we drew the lines for this beautiful boat, when we built her in New Zealand and sailed her for the first time in Auckland Harbour, I was the happiest person on earth. If my life had ended there and then, I would have been absolutely ecstatic. It was unreal. And that journey to sail halfway around the world in training, to sail the boat twice across the Atlantic, to then sail around the world in a race called the Vendée Globe, a solo non-stop race where you leave for 3.5 months racing against 24 other competitors from France back to France but via the Antarctic was an extraordinary experience. It was everything that I had ever dreamt of. Sailing along with dolphins swimming next to the boat was absolutely incredible. And day after day, night after night, you're on the ocean. It's what I dreamt of. And it's a very different world out there. When you sail around the world, 24/7, that boat is moving. There is never a moment when you can say, I will sleep now for 10 minutes, or even 5 minutes, because anything can quite literally happen at any moment. So you sleep for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, sometimes 20 minutes, very rarely. In fact, recovering is something that's very challenging, because that boat never stops, because that boat is always moving. And when you're sailing around the world, I think many people imagine that you see the coastline and the beaches and you wave to people. But actually, you're very lucky if you see the land at all. I saw the land only twice in that round the world. One was Cape Horn, the tip of South America, and the other was an island in the Southern Ocean. And when you're in that Southern Ocean, you're actually 2,500 miles away from the nearest town. So if something goes wrong, if you break your leg, as has happened in that race before, it can take 5 days for a ship to get to you, and then 5 days, if they can get you off the boat safely, to get you back into port, into a hospital. There's no support vessels, and there's no one there on standby to get you off. So you really do sail in the middle of nowhere. Now, I finished the Vendée Globe in second position, and I loved the experience so much, the Southern Ocean so much, that I decided, really, as soon as I finished the Vendée, I'd go again. But the second time, not in that race, the second time to try and be the fastest person ever to sail solo non-stop around the world. And this needed a different boat. The record stood at 94 days. The record was held by a monohull, like Kingfisher, the boat you saw in the previous slides. I needed a multi-hull in order to break the record. They're faster, but they're also more dangerous. And just to give the impression of what that boat is like, if you imagine racing through icebergs, if you imagine racing 2,500 miles away from anywhere, if you imagine racing in a boat like this, a boat which quite literally can travel at 35, 40 knots, a boat which can go wrong very quickly, just to give you an idea of scale, the mast on that boat, the bit that holds the sails up, I could climb inside right to the top. 75 foot long, 60 foot wide, and incredibly powerful. And just to show you how powerful, this was a training sail in a smaller boat with a French friend. This was sailed by 11 guys, and they flipped upside down in a few seconds. Obviously, that wasn't the intention. And when you see the images on the right-hand side of that boat clinging onto the net, and how far below them the sea is, imagine that in the middle of the night, 2,500 miles away from the nearest town. And that capsizing, that flipping upside down, is something I did understand. Because whilst training for that round the world, I did capsize with four French friends, 60 miles off the Portuguese coast, and that happened in 5 seconds. We hit something, there was a little knock, and then 5 seconds later, our world went black. Because although it was the daytime, the windows of that boat go under the water. And your world goes dark, and you're going out of the escape hatches trying to find one of your best friends who you know is trapped underneath those nets. And multi-hulls are fast. So you imagine driving a car. If you drove a car at 10 kilometers an hour, 20 kilometers an hour, it's quite slow, it's quite straightforward. It's not that stressful. Take that to 30, 40, 50. You begin to concentrate more, 60, 70, 80. You're actually concentrating very carefully on the road. Take that to 90, 100, 200 kilometers an hour. You have white knuckles. You're trying to keep that car on the road. In this case, it's that fast, but you don't have a windscreen, you don't have a road, and you don't have headlights. So you're pushing as hard as you can, and your stress levels are up here. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It doesn't stop from day one when you leave to the 71st day when I broke that record. And just imagine for a moment what it's like. If I said to you all, go off into Dublin, find everything that you will need for your survival for the next 3 months, everything. That's food, fuel, clothing, repairs, medical equipment, everything. That's what we do before we leave for a journey like that. And when we leave for that journey, we manage what we have down to the last drop of diesel for the generator, the last packet of food, and the last item of clothing. And what you develop on that boat is the most overwhelming understanding of what finite really means. What you have is all you have. There is no more. If you run out and the batteries run flat because you have no more diesel, 5 seconds later, your boat will be upside down because the autopilot that steers it can no longer function without electricity. So you manage everything. And I'd never, ever translated that feeling of finite, that understanding of what finite resources means on that boat, to anything outside. But when I set foot off the boat at the finish line, I suddenly did that. I suddenly translated that notion of finite to our global economy. And for me, it was a bit like just seeing something under a stone, something I actually didn't really want to see because I was living my dream job. I was going to be sailing until I was 100 years old. It's all I had ever wanted to do. But I couldn't put that stone down. I couldn't stop and turn away. I had to start to learn more. I had to begin to understand, how do we use resources in our global economy? How does it function? How does it work? I'd never even thought of global economics before, let alone tried to understand how they worked. And so I began a four-year journey of learning, of speaking to experts, scientists, chief executives, to try and look at this global economic model, to try and understand how we use resources. And one place I went, and one material I looked at, was coal, used so much around the world to create energy, to drive our industrial revolution. We still have in the UK many coal-fired power stations, and I went to visit one, just to see how they work. And this photo was taken in the burner, obviously not lit, because if it was, it would have been 2,000 degrees and I wouldn't be standing here. But it was amazing to see this incredible cavern that we've built to drive, to create steam, to drive turbines, to create energy. It was 180 feet tall, like looking up into a cathedral. It was quite extraordinary. It was an amazing experience to understand how this was used to generate energy. And whilst I was there, it struck me that coal was a subject very close to my heart, because my family in the past were coal miners. This is my great-grandfather. And obviously that's an old photo. He was a coal miner. In fact, he spent 50 years of his life underground. And when you see that photo, you see another era. This isn't now. This isn't modern times. Nobody wears trousers that come quite that high these days. Or at least the fashion hasn't come back yet. But I remembered my great-grandfather because I was with him. This is me with him. And by the way, they are not his real ears. And I remember his stories. I remember sitting on his knee, him talking about the camaraderie underground, the fact that he worked underground with ponies. And when the ponies retired from the pits, they would live around the mouth of the pit, and the miners would save the crusts of their sandwiches so they could give them to their old friends that they'd worked underground, often for decades with. I was fascinated by this. And when I went on my journey of learning, one place I went to was the World Coal Association, just to understand how much might we have left. In the middle of the homepage back then, it said, "We're not about to run out of coal. We've got about 118 years left." And I stopped and I thought, well, you know, that's much longer than the prognosis we hear for oil, but that's well outside my lifetime. And then I stopped and I thought, and I did the maths, and I realized that my great-grandfather was born exactly 118 years before that year. And I sat on his knee until I was 11 years old. And it's nothing. It's nothing in time. And it made me make the decision that I never thought I would make, which was to leave the sport of solo sailing behind and focus on a much greater challenge: how our global economy actually functions. And I realized quite quickly, it's not just coal and oil and materials that produce energy, it's also the materials themselves: metals, plastics, polymers. These materials also, we only have once in the history of humanity, yet we're using them at a vast rate. And in fact, this study in The New Scientist back in 2008, when I was learning about this, showed how many years left it thought. Copper and zinc, about 40 years. It talked about indium in every single LCD screen, 13 years. Currently, none of that is cycled. And then you look at the speed at which we use resources. It has increased rapidly across the world. And one thing we do know, as we see that line get steeper and steeper, is that line can't go vertical because it's based on finite materials. And in the global economy, the result of that has been that we've seen a century of price declines erased in just 10 years. This is the McKinsey Global Commodity Index. And we now see not only that increase in price, but also more volatility than we've ever seen before in history of these raw material prices. We have 3 billion new middle-class consumers moving into the marketplace. We have more and more demand for these materials. And yet we continue to use that finite supply. And to put that in context, one figure which really astounded me was between January 2011 and January 2012, your average European car manufacturer saw an increase in raw material price of 500 million euros in just 1 year. How can you pass that on to your customer? How can you take that amount of price increase and that not seriously affect your business model? And I realized, actually, this was a challenge for many businesses across the world. How can we function in this economy which is so linear? An economy where we drive it by taking something out of the ground, making something out of it, and then ultimately that product gets thrown away. It's a very linear economy. And so much of the conversation I had with experts, with CEOs, when challenging them about this middle business model was, so what's the solution? If we have finite resources, if we have this increase in raw material prices, what can we do? And so much of that strategy was about, we need to do less. We need to be more efficient with our use of resources. And even from a business context, let's make a car with less material in every year. Let's use less energy to make that car every year, which is vital in the transition, because these resources are finite. But is it the solution? Because if you take that model and you apply it every year for the next 10 or 20 years, do you end up not making any cars because there's no material going in and not employing any people within your manufacturing organization? So was that the solution? And this fascinated me, because 3 years of learning had led to, we need to use less. And for me, that wasn't that burning goal inside, that goal that I'd felt as a four-year-old child saying, this is where I'm going. I want to sail around the world. Using less wasn't something that would unlock innovation and creativity. We needed something to aim for. And then I met people who thought very differently. One was the chief executive of a carpet manufacturing company in Holland. He didn't say to his workforce, I want to make a carpet more efficiently. He said, I want to build a carpet that's made to be made again. A carpet that's designed for disassembly. A carpet whereby I actually don't want to sell. We don't want to sell because we want it back. We want to be able to disassemble it, recover the yarn, recover the base, turn the yarn by depolymerization and repolymerization into the yarn of the next carpet, melt the base down and turn the base into the base of the next carpet, and doing that ultimately using entirely renewable energy by 2025. It was a totally different approach, a much more circular approach. Imagine that applied to a vehicle. Imagine that applied to a washing machine, a mobile phone. What if everything, the first line on the design brief was, we need to design this for disassembly, we need to be able to recover the materials, we need to be able to remanufacture, upgrade, we need to innovate with new materials to enable this to happen, we need to change business models to enable this to happen. Suddenly you have an economy that functions in an entirely different way, whereby products, components, and materials are kept at their highest value at all times within the global economy. And we never see waste, because at the beginning, it's designed out of the system. And that's technical. What about biological materials? What about food waste, human waste, agricultural waste? Is this designed to fit into a system whereby it can flow back into the global economy? Today, no. In many cases, it's not. Yet this has value. This has nutritional value for food and farming, for agriculture. This has been returning to the ground for billions of years. Is this a different way of looking at the global economy? Technical, biological, a much more circular economy. And there, I was truly inspired, because this was a systems level change, not just design, not just how products are put together and remanufactured, but the business model, the way the economy functions. It fascinated me because it was an entire systems level change. You actually couldn't take one part of the economy out of that rethinking, because it was an entire system. And for me, that was that feeling that I had as a child, that feeling of anything is possible, that feeling of something to aim for. And so when we created the Ellen MacArthur Foundation back in September 2010, we were a small team, but through the idea of a circular economy, we were able to raise 6 million of funds from corporates through looking at a different business model, through challenging on the business model and looking at this circular opportunity. And we chose right then to work in three areas: to work in education, to work with business, and to work on analysis, because we believed you need an entire generation of young people leaving education thinking differently. You need businesses to act quickly, because this is a different model that's more resilient for them in the long term, and they can act quickly. And we needed the analysis to prove the economics, to show whether the business case worked for a circular economy. And then when we launched, we didn't know. So we went to McKinsey. We went to one of the best management consultants in the world, and we asked them three questions about the circular economy to write report one, a a report based on medium complexity goods in Europe, goods that cycle in more than 1 year and less than 10. And the answer to the three questions was all yes. Number one, does the circular economy have the potential to decouple growth from resource constraints? We split the economy into those two halves, biological, technical. Biological materials cascading through the economy, technical materials, cars, polymers, plastics, anything that could be technically cycled within the economy, things effectively that don't biodegrade. And then we applied that to a mobile phone. And we said, if we could recover mobile phones, if we could remanufacture mobile phones, could we shift that use of resources? The answer was yes. You shift from 85% going to landfill to 50. And there was a value to that. We saw that the amount of business as usual material used within that sector of the global economy shifted considerably. And yes, there's question two, it also worked for business. So the question was, does the circular economy unlock more value for business? And we found that yes, it did. If you took the example of a washing machine, current washing machines of today are designed to last for as long as we're happy with and to wash our clothes, but they'll cost you 27 cents a wash. If you take a high-end machine that most of us can't afford, that'll only cost you 12 cents a wash, but it's designed to be repaired. Within a circular economy, we wouldn't buy the machine. Because when we buy a machine, we pay tax when we buy it. We buy all the materials in that machine. We buy the copper, the concrete, the metals. And then when we throw that machine away in the UK, we pay landfill tax. Within a circular economy, you pay per wash. The manufacturer owns the materials, the machine. They make sure it's repairable, upgradable, remanufacturable. And then when a better model comes out, they take it back, they disassemble it, they recover the materials and feed them into the next system. They gain because they no longer have to buy those raw materials. From our perspective, we pay 12 cents a wash rather than the 27 we pay today. We get a better deal. We never have to buy it. We don't have to worry about repairing it. It's a service model. But everything shifts, the design, the usage. We actually become users within a circular economy. And the third question, is it good for the wider economy? In the EU alone, it was worth $630 billion per year. Second report, we looked at faster moving consumer goods, this time globally. Again, many questions. This is a 3.2 trillion market, and we currently only collect 20% of that. $68 billion per year of textiles disappear into the global marketplace because we haven't set up the flows of materials. We haven't turned this into value, but this all has value, but only if it's designed to fit within a flow, only if we manage it within the flow so that flow of materials can go back to base. The value of this to the global economy, even through the faster moving consumer goods, which we thought was hard, was $706 billion per year. And so what we saw when moving on to our third report was over $1 trillion of value. We began conversations with the World Economic Forum, where we launched our reports. We've kicked off a two-year project with the World Economic Forum, working with regions, working with some of the biggest businesses in the world, looking at trying to find the stalemates in the global economy that are stopping us from unlocking this circular economy at speed. What we also find is there's not only just a massive economic opportunity right now for the taking, looking through a circular economic lens, but it's also an opportunity for developing countries. Because we here in the developed world have built a linear system. In the developing world, there is an opportunity to leapfrog that system and go straight to a circular one, making it better for us as the user and more resilient as the manufacturer. It changes the entire system. And we talk entirely about this being an opportunity there for the taking. We work with the European Commission. We work with our global partners. Big global businesses, all with a circular economy strategy now, putting this in place. And they're not there now, but they're on a journey to unlocking this different economy. They're putting everything in place, and they're saying, this is where we're going. This is the direction. It's not an aside, it's a general direction to become more circular and more resilient. We built a global platform, the CE100, to bring together businesses, regions, universities from all over the world, including small emerging innovators. And now we work with some of the most incredible small companies who have phenomenal ideas. I'll come to some of those in a minute. But also some of the biggest businesses in the world, not just our global partners, but IKEA, Apple, Coke, H&M, big organizations who are also fascinated by this model and want to learn more, want to try and unlock this through working together. which is very much the goal of this platform. We have an international university network through the Schmidt MacArthur Fellowship Program, whereby we not only run fellowships for students, but we also bring along a mentor from the university, some of the top universities in the world, to a summer school to embed circular economy teaching and learning within universities to create research opportunities in material science, innovation, thinking creatively about how we can redesign the economy. We have our Disruptive Innovation Festival, which kicks off in less than a week's time. We are now in a world where we can change the world from a tablet, whereby we can have an idea and share it with the world in seconds. The Disruptive Innovation Festival is about getting ideas, creativity, the best thinking, the best inspiration around circular economy to everyone in the world. It's online, it's a 4-week festival, anyone can come in and learn and become entrepreneurial around these ideas, because we believe there's a massive opportunity, not just for the big businesses, but for those small emerging innovators that we see all the time. So I urge you to go online and see what it's all about and get interactive with our festival. And then to finish, just a few case studies. Michelin, if you're a US truck manufacturer, you wouldn't buy your tires. You pay per mile to Michelin, and they provide road miles of tires. They then build the best tire possible. They take it back, they remanufacture it, and it comes back to your truck. You get an amazing service. Ricoh, printers and photocopiers, they get remanufactured, disassembled, ultrasonically cleaned, upgraded. They go back out of the door with the same warranty as a new one for significantly less than a new one, and they make more profit out of it. It's a win-win situation. Renault, they remanufacture engines. Currently, they remanufacture engines that come from the entire Renault network that are broken. Yet they take them into this plant, they disassemble them, again, they ultrasonically clean them, they remanufacture them into engines which have the same warranty as a brand new engine. They sell them at significantly less than a brand new engine, and they make more profit on those engines. In fact, that remanufacturing plant is the most profitable Renault factory in the world to date. They've also changed their business models with cars. So with their range of electric cars, when you buy one, you don't buy the battery. It's the most expensive part. You buy the car, and your battery is guaranteed to be changed every single time it reaches 75% of capacity. You lease the battery effectively, which means that the materials in that battery go back into the economy. Something quite different, buying mobile phones back. This isn't at the design end, but the business model end. Mizuno Mobile in the UK and Australia, they buy back our old phones. They've seen there's value in them because they can sell them into secondary markets, or they can use them as repaired phones when we break our phone. So they saw value at the end of our mobile phone contracts, and now the mobile phone contractors themselves have changed the model so that the companies like Mizuno are put out to the side, because even Vodafone itself now has a red-hot tariff whereby you lease the phone. That's in the small print. They sell it as Vodafone Red Hot. You get a refresh of technology every 12 months. You get the best phones available. You pay less than the standard tariff. Why wouldn't you do that? When the iPhone 9 comes out, we don't need the iPhone 8. As a user, we just need that tablet in our hand or that phone in our hand to enable us to do what we need to do. Different business model. Turn two, lighting. This is a Dutch model whereby if you're any company and you have office space, you don't pay for the lighting and you don't buy the light fittings. You pay to have 400 lumens at desk height. Philips work with Turn 2, they provide the lighting, they pay the electricity bill, Philips. So it's in Philips' interest to put the best possible system in place that's the most energy efficient in place. When they've got more efficient technology, they change it because they pay the electricity bill, and then they take that lighting back and they can remanufacture it within their system because it's theirs. They own it, they can design it to do that. Bolts, designed so the thread disassembles automatically when it's put in a specific solution at a certain temperature. Same with circuit boards, recovering the components of circuit boards so they can either be disassembled into their constituent parts or put back into other equipment. Biological side, bags that are designed to fit within a cycle. That bag, actually made by Puma, is designed to be biologically non-toxic. So you put it in water, stir it around, and it disappears. It can go down the drains. There's nothing toxic about that bag whatsoever, because it's designed by intention from the outset for that biological cycle. Splosh do something similar. They've designed a system for cleaning products. So that system comes to your house in a cardboard box. You get the bottles, and they send refills through the post that you drop into the container, add hot water, and even the packaging around that refill totally dissolves and disappears into the fluid, and then that is non-toxic, biodegradable, and can go down your sink because it's designed for the biosphere. Growing packaging, Eben Bayer in the States. Here, he decided to replace styrofoam, because styrofoam ultimately becomes very definitely a waste product, replace it by mushrooms. Sounds crazy, but he has customers now like Dell and Steelcase. He uses farm waste with mycelium, and he grows this packaging to match styrofoam. He's at price parity with styrofoam. And just to finish, for the final few seconds, when I look at this shift in global economy, it's a massive shift. To shift our economy from linear to circular is huge. But when I ever question that, I think about what is possible. And I think about what's happened within a lifetime. When my great-grandfather was born, there were 25 cars on the road in the entire world. They'd only just been invented. When he was 14, we flew for the first time in history. He remembered that. Now, 3 times the population of the world back then fly every single year. When he was 40, we developed the first computer. Many said it wouldn't catch on, but it did. And within 20 years, we turned that into a microchip, of which there will be millions of in this room here today. 10 years before my great-grandfather died, the mobile phone arrived. Not that mobile, but what it has allowed is entirely different infrastructure in different countries to bypass some of that linear thinking, to sidestep the massive infrastructure that was needed with our wires in the ground. And as my great-grandfather left this earth, the internet arrived. If ever there is a time that we can redesign the global economy so that it really can function in the long term, it's now. Thank you.
Thank you so much. You just, thank you. Thank you so much, Dame Ellen. An absolute privilege to have you here.